tonight, so we'll see how many. Hello, we're here. Hello, I'm here with Dr. Ovadia. He fixes hearts. So Dr. Ovadia, would you please tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure thing.
And why you came to eating meat?
Sure thing. Great thing to be here with you.
Thank you.
I came to eating meat because I was a heart surgeon that was going to end up on my own operating table. I was morbidly obese. I was pre-diabetic. And I was following the advice that I had been taught to give my patients. And I recognized that it wasn't working for me and it wasn't working for my patients. So, you know, I started looking for some different answers. I think I started asking some different questions, which was an important part of the journey. And eventually I started on a low carbohydrate dietary approach. And that really got me great results. And for the first time in my life, I was able to lose weight and maintain the weight loss, and really just improvements in so many other areas of my life. And, you know, over time, it got lower and lower carb. And then I heard about this crazy carnivore diet. And I said, well, that sounds pretty insane to only eat meat. At that point I was doing very low carbohydrate, and I said, I'm really not eating much besides meat, so let me give it a try. And I did, and I noticed even further improvement. And, you know, as I've understood more about the science behind all this and realized how it can benefit the patients that I take care of every day as a heart surgeon, I really just came to recognize that I think red meat is the best thing that human beings can be eating and should be eating. I think at this point we have enough evidence to thoroughly disprove the myth that I still deal with every day that red meat is bad for the heart. And so I have now been on a primarily carnivorous diet for the past 4 years. I think we're actually coming up on 5 years, and I'm in the best shape of my life. So I'm sticking with it.
That's awesome. Yeah. When you see doctors that are like overweight giving advice on health, I think it is like a little, I don't know, deceptive, or you'll feel like, are they giving me the right advice?
Well, yeah, I think it should make us question, you know, are they giving us the right advice, or are they just, you know, not able to follow the advice? And that's a problem in and of itself, because if we as physicians are giving advice that patients simply can't follow, then we have to start to question that advice. And this, I think, is where, you know, the low calorie diet, you know, when I look at the low calorie diet, yes, every time I went on a calorie restriction diet, I lost weight, but I was never able to maintain it. So, you know, what use is that if the patient simply can't maintain it? And that's the bottom line, is you can't starve yourself. You know, our internal drive to obtain enough nutrients is, you know, one of our most powerful, it's almost like a reflex. You know, it is literally impossible to suppress that over the long term. So if you're hungry all the time with whatever dietary strategy you're choosing to follow, that is ultimately not going to be successful.
Sure. Yeah, that makes sense. When I was promoting this live stream, someone commented, interesting cardiologist that promotes eating meat. I don't think it was negative, honestly. And then the next statement was, have you heard of the China study and or forks over knives? And all I said is, yes, I've heard of that. But I'm curious, what is your opinion of a diet that is primarily plant-based? And is that healthy for the human heart?
So plant-based diets have been repeatedly shown to be better than standard Western diets full of processed food. And I don't deny that. So, you know, ultimately, I think that eating whole real food, and I'm going to qualify that last statement by saying whole food plant-based diets, okay? Because plant-based diets can actually incorporate a lot of processed junk food, and they're not going to be beneficial. You know, we all know that that Oreos are vegan, right? So, but you know, when you look at a whole food plant-based diet, it is clearly better than a standard Western diet. I think many people do get health improvements, because they're eliminating processed food. And so first and foremost, you know, I would say my, you know, first principle when it comes to eating is eat whole real food. Now that can include plant matter and that can include animal matter. And that can include combinations of both. And I think, you know, depending on people's circumstances, there may be a role for any of the anything that's on the spectrum of eating whole real food. The difficulties I see with a whole food plant-based dietary approach is it is nutritionally incomplete. And even the vegan doctors, you know, advocates don't deny this. You have to take supplements. And all of the people that have success on long-term plant-based diets are supplementing. And, you know, it's a complicated diet, because you have to get your protein sources right and you have to plan. And the other, I think, challenge around it is that you are basically eating all the time. When you look at herbivores, you know, animals that eat primarily plants, they literally sit there and eat all day. And, you know, all of our favorite animal, the cow, is an herbivore. And when you observe cows, what do? They stand out in the fields and they literally eat all day long. And the only time they're not eating basically is when they're sleeping. So, and quite frankly, my colleagues, and there are many of them that are on plant-based diets, I observe the same behavior. I'm like, you are eating all day long. And meanwhile, I can be over here. I have my one steak at night and I'm good to go for another 24 hours. So those are some of the factors that I think favor a carnivore diet over a whole food plant-based diet. But if the choice for someone, for whatever reason, is between a Western diet, a standard American diet, and a whole food plant-based diet, yeah, I'm going to tell that person, eat your whole food plant-based diet. Make sure you take your supplements. Make sure you plan your protein sources correctly. And you're probably going to get improvement from that.
Okay, awesome. Brooke has a question. If someone was having a difficult time with affordable animal protein, what are the best and most bioavailable plant-based options?
Well, so first I want to, you know, I guess take a little issue with Brooke's question about affordability of animal-based proteins. Mm-hmm. Animal-based proteins can be very affordable. And, you know, what I tell people is you don't have to have the, you know, grass-fed, regeneratively raised, you know, organic beef. You can, and I know plenty of people who do this dietary approach with the least expensive, you know, animal protein that they can find. Beef, eggs are very affordable, although maybe that's changed some in the last few years. But you can do this very affordably. And the other thing to take into consideration is you end up eating less often on a carnivore diet and you really end up wasting less food. So when we think about the price of animal protein versus the nutrient density, it really comes out to be the best value. Now, if you're going to turn to plant-based options for your protein sources, you're going to be looking at things, you know, beans and things like that. And I'm going to admit that I'm not really an expert at plant-based proteins because I don't consume them. But, you know, find a good resource. And there are plenty out there on, you know, how to construct a good plant-based diet and vary your protein. You know, the problem with plant-based proteins is they are all incomplete. you can't get the essential amino acids that you need from one particular plant-based protein, and you need to mix and match them to get the whole spectrum. And that says in opposition to meat, that, you know, red meat provides us with all of the essential amino acids that we need. It is a complete protein source. And so, you know, you can literally just eat red meat as the only component of your diet, and you're going to get every nutrient that you need.
It's so wild. It's so wild. So Brooke wanted to just add 2 points. She asked that because people ask her. So she's on a carnivore diet, but people ask her that. And then she said she had the answer. But now it's on record forever on YouTube.
There we go.
And then Carrie says, hello, Alia and Dr. Ovadia. All right. So I had another question. So you mentioned, like, on your website, and you've said this in various videos, but what measurements can a person take to, like, measure their metabolic health? Not just blood. I mean, you can answer blood tests also, but I know that you do like measuring with a tape.
So there were 5 basic measurements of metabolic health. Understand these aren't my measurements. These are well-accepted measurements of metabolic health. And, you know, 2 of them you can do at home. Your waist circumference, which is where the tape measure comes into play. Take a tape measure just above the level of your belly button. Measure it first thing in the morning. If you're a man, you want that to be less than 40 inches. If you're a woman, you want it to be less than 35 inches. The next metric is your blood pressure. You want your blood pressure to be less than 130 over 85. Both of those numbers, top number needs to be less than 130, bottom number needs to be less than 85. That needs to be without the use of medication. If you're on medication for high blood pressure, it's an indicator that you're not metabolically healthy. The final 3 metrics come from basic blood work. And again, most doctors get the blood work. They just don't put it in the context of metabolic health. So you want to look at your fasting blood glucose level. Alternatively, you can look at your hemoglobin A1C, which is, you know, your average blood glucose over about a 3-month period. You want your fasting blood glucose level to be less than 100, or you want your hemoglobin A1C to be 5.6 or less. And again, without the use of medication, if you've been diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, it's another indicator that you're not metabolically healthy. And then we're going to look at that cholesterol panel, but we're not going to look at the one number that your doctor probably focused on, the LDL cholesterol level. We're going to look at your HDL cholesterol level. And many people refer to this as good cholesterol. And the reason they do so is because we know we want more of it. So you want this number to be higher, which is confusing, because all we hear about is less cholesterol, less cholesterol, less cholesterol. You actually want your HDL to be higher. If you're a man, you want it to be over 40 milligrams per deciliter. If you're a woman, you want it to be over 50 milligrams per deciliter. Okay. And then we're going to look at your triglyceride level, which is another number on that lipid panel. This we want to be lower. And the official criteria for metabolic health is for that to be less than 150 milligrams per deciliter. Now, 2 things to understand here. Number one is, I think most of those criteria are actually too generous, and there's probably an ideal range that's, you know, better than those. But if we accept those 5 measures, the most recent data we have shows that 88% of the adults in the United States cannot meet all 5 measures of metabolic health. So pretty shocking statistic. And it just shows how unhealthy we are as a society.
Sure. I can't. And I've been eating pretty good this way for almost a year. And I still don't think I would make all of those. I'll check my belly button measurement tomorrow.
There we go. And see.
But that's because of 40 years of probably eating terribly and smoking.
Yeah, you know, and it does, you know, that's a very good point. People think sometimes they get the impression that, you know, you go on a carnivore diet and magically everything is fixed in a week or two. And yes, you can see improvements very quickly, but sometimes it takes quite a while to get to optimal, especially if you've, you know, not been healthy for many, many years. You know, we can't undo decades of damage in days or weeks.
Right, right. And most of my damage was probably due to somewhat of yo-yo dieting. And my yo-yo that worked the best was Atkins. And then I'd be like, oh, look how skinny I got. And then I just go back to eating crap.
Right.
And I think that's really bad for the body in the long run.
Going back to the crap. Yeah. And, you know, we do see the concern, you know, what I tell people is once you've been obese, you know, it can be hard to overcome that. I mean, honestly, you know, I still have subcutaneous fat, right? So, although my metabolic health numbers are all within range, when I've done the scans, I have very little visceral fat on the inside, which is really the dangerous type of fat. The subcutaneous fat, you know, can be very challenging. And the older you are, the harder it is to lose all that. And so, you know, all of us want the, you know, the six pack and, you know, there are a lot of influencers out there who have never been obese and, you know, they kind of will say, well, if you don't have the six pack, you're not, you know, obviously you're doing something wrong. And I want people to understand that that's probably, you know, that's not the truth. You can be metabolically healthy and, you know, not be a perfect physical specimen. you know, there's a lot of factors that go into that. And, we really, you know, when I work with people, we're focused on improvement. We're focused on stopping the progression of disease like heart disease. You know, if you end up with the six pack, great. But it's really not a health metric, you know, and the flip side of that is you can have a health, you can have the six pack and still be unhealthy. So we got to acknowledge that part of it too.
Right. Yeah. That's a very good point. I think where I became like obese was after I had kids. Cause I just, you know, when I was pregnant, I was like, oh, I can eat whatever I want. It'll just come right off when I'm nursing. It's not true.
Yeah. Yeah. Unfortunately, many women learn that lesson. And even though it might be true for the first child, it usually isn't true for the second and third ones that follow. It becomes harder and harder.
Yeah. So I was still very overweight. I got pregnant 11 months after my son was born and I was very overweight still. I actually lost weight in that pregnancy and then just gained it back because I had eating issues, not like disorder. I just couldn't eat. You know, sometimes that happens when you're pregnant, but still. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And I had kids later. I think if you're young, if you're like in your 20s, it's like easier. That's just my assumption from moms I've seen that are young that.
Yeah, I think a lot of this gets, it all gets more difficult the older we get. But, you know, with that being said, I've seen 70 and 80 year olds, you know, institute these changes and go on low carb carnivore diets and, you know, have really pretty amazing results. And, you know, I mean, I can truly say that as I am coming up on my 50th birthday here in a few months, I feel and look better and am better by every health metric that I can imagine today than I was in my 20s. You know, I tell people the best day to start is always today, but it's never too late to start, you know.
Great. That's great advice. Brooke says in her 20s, she used to take diet pills. One of them was starting to affect her heart and she broke out in hives. That sounds kind of scary.
Yeah. Not a good situation. I think ultimately medications, and this of course is a hot topic, you know, weight loss medications. I really think that they have a minimal if any, role in this process. You know, and if you are going to use them, they need to be in addition to making the lifestyle changes. You know, right, there may be a role for using them, maybe to help jumpstart the process. But you got to have that long-term plan. You can't be on these medications forever. Right. There are many concerning side effects of the weight loss medications. And so you got to have a plan for getting off them and then being able to maintain. And that's where, you know, it's got to be paired with effective diet and lifestyle advice.
Right. Okay, cool. And then who's your carnivore, Brett? Could you explain how people's arteries clog up? If it's not from fat, then what causes it?
Well, you know, understand that it's not that cholesterol doesn't play a role in the process. I think people sometimes, again, get the wrong message. The message that I'm trying to get people to understand is, yes, cholesterol plays a role in the process, but it's not the driving force of the process. It's mm-hmm. not the most important risk factor. And it's not as simple as looking at one number on your blood test to figure out, you know, is cholesterol problematic or not. What I try and get people to focus on is quality of your cholesterol, not quantity. That's what's important. So, the reason that people's arteries clog up starts with damage being done to the blood vessel wall, and at the same time, damage being done to their cholesterol particles, their cholesterol carrying particles, I should say, in their bloodstream. And normally, if your blood vessel wall gets damaged, cholesterol is actually part of the repair process to repair that damage. And if your cholesterol carrying particles are not damaged, they repair the blood vessel wall and then they go away. They don't accumulate and lead to plaque formation. But if they are damaged themselves, and the thing that leads to damage of your cholesterol carrying particles are insulin resistance and inflammation. So if you don't have those two things, if you don't have inflammation, you don't have insulin resistance, you know, you may not, even if you are damaging your blood vessel walls, you still may not get atherosclerosis. And of course, figure out what's damaging your blood vessel walls first and foremost and get rid of that. And again, that brings us back to insulin resistance, inflammation. Now, you know, you mentioned earlier in life that you were a smoker.
Yes.
Smoking is a situation, you know, when you look at smokers, they are at very increased risk of atherosclerosis, heart attacks. However, smoking doesn't raise cholesterol. So right. It shows mm-hmm. us that something else is going on here. And the something mm-hmm. else that's going on is that smoking is directly, you know, the chemicals in cigarettes that then get into our bloodstream are damaging to the blood vessels. And mm-hmm. again, that repeated damage to the blood vessel is ultimately going to lead to atherosclerosis. Now, the other thing to understand about this question is the cholesterol that we eat in things like red meat and eggs really has very little, maybe essentially zero influence on our blood cholesterol levels and on the quality of the cholesterol in our bloodstream. The vast majority of the cholesterol that's in our bloodstream is being made by the body. And it really has very little and maybe mm-hmm. nothing to do with the cholesterol that we're eating. But if you're eating
that,
yeah,
that's
an important thing that, and that's a very important misconception that many doctors continue to have that, you know, the cholesterol that we eat ends up determining what our blood cholesterol levels are.
Okay, that's great. So I just want to talk about this smoking thing for a second. So I started smoking to be a rebel one day before my 18th birthday. That's probably the most rebellious thing I've ever done. But I smoked until the day that I saw I had a positive pregnancy test. And I always say I don't remember if I smoked my last cigarette or I just threw the cigarettes away or I gave them to somebody else. But I quit that day, which I think also led to me eating more than I should have during pregnancy to replace the habit of 17 years of constantly putting something in your mouth. Have you heard of dengue fever by any chance?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so I live in Colombia and I got dengue fever once and it was terrible. I was hospitalized for several days. And there's no, you just have to get through it. You have to like survive it basically. But they had to put IVs in me and then they kept popping out and not that I like my veins were weak. And she said it was because she's like, you must have been a smoker. Is this probably why they kept having to find new veins to stick the IV in?
You know, probably not, to be honest. Again, oh, sort okay. of a common misconception. You know, so understand, you know, so the first thing here is IVs are going in veins. They're not going in arteries. And oh. we really, we don't have okay. evidence that smoking really damages the veins. It primarily damages the arteries. So the two okay. probably have nothing to do with each other. But common misconception. I'm not surprised to hear that you know, a nurse or a medical person may have said something like that to you.
Yeah. Okay. Well, now that that's clear, because I was curious about that for years. Okay. So we've got some more questions here. Susan says there's a Netflix documentary comparing diets of weightlifters, Arnold Schwarzenegger era, and today's weightlifters. First, more meat and fat with better physique and carb heavy thicker. I don't know. I don't follow bodybuilders, but I guess that makes sense. What's your take on that?
Yeah. You know, not an area of expertise for me, but something I've certainly heard. And my understanding is, yeah, the old school approach to bodybuilding was lots of animal protein. You know, we can all think about the classic kind of trope, you know, from for me, it's from the Rocky movie where he's starting the morning by gulping like six, you know, putting six eggs into a glass and drinking it down. Yeah. And yeah, they ate lots of meat and lots of animal protein. And, you know, that's that contributed to their physiques, you know, so. I haven't seen that documentary, but it wouldn't surprise me.
There you go.
Unfortunately, Arnold Schwarzenegger has put himself in the plant-based camp, although by all evidence, he is not plant-based. He just, from my understanding, has investments in some of these fake meat companies and was kind of behind one of the plant-based documentaries a few years ago.
Oh, how odd. How strange.
Yeah.
There we go. And Adam says, carnivore today, how can the average person help to shift the mainstream belief that fat is going to give them a heart attack?
Well, ultimately, I tell people the best way to help shift the public belief is just demonstrate the results and live your life. You know, as much as I personally, and I think a lot of people in this community want to, you know, change the narrative, change the mainstream thinking, you know, it's really about the grassroots movement, you know, doing this one person at a time, demonstrating your own, improvements. And you know, in conjunction with some of the grassroots science that's being done, you know, together, I think we are going to be able to overcome this. What I try and do is again look for that common ground. So you know, what I tried to do in my book was look at diets that support metabolic health. Different dietary approaches that support metabolic health and figure out what they have in common. And the best commonality that I could find is elimination of processed food. And that's what's led me to, again, my high level advice of eat real food. eliminate the processed food, and, you know, you're going to get improvements. And then figure out, you know, based on your situation, you know, how much plant product, how much animal product you want to incorporate. And then, you know, and then you got to judge the results. Again, you know, go back to the five basic metrics. You can use some more advanced metrics if you want. But if the diet is helping you improve your metabolic health, then great, stick with it. If it's not, we got to reevaluate.
Great. Okay. Let's see here. All right, Carrie, my LDL 272, HDL 78, triglycerides 89, had a CAC scan Monday. We'll get the results soon. I'm metabolically healthy, good on all measurements. I'm 57. Carrie, you don't look 57. Okay. If score isn't zero, what would I do? I'm carnivore.
Very good question. So first of all, I think we set a new record 32 minutes into the live stream, and I hadn't gotten someone sending me their cholesterol. Usually it's within the first five minutes that we have cholesterol numbers flying through the comments. So, So, you know, these numbers all look good from a metabolic health standpoint. Of course, I don't know your other numbers. So CAC scan, coronary artery calcium scan. And what that scan does is it tells you at its early stages, do you have evidence of plaque, calcified plaque in your arteries? And it's a great screening test that I really advocate for people to get. If your score is not zero today, the goal is to make sure it doesn't get worse over time. And this is the primary thing that I work on with patients in my telemedicine practice. You know, wherever you are today, if you stop it from getting worse, you're probably going to be all right. And the issue is, and I don't know how, well, I do know, Carrie said she's 57. So, you know, you get your first scan at 57 and it's not zero. Was that damage done in the past week, past month, past year, or was that damage done 20 and 30 years ago? And we really have no way of knowing that. What we can do though, is we say, okay, today I'm starting at whatever your number is, and let me continue what I'm doing, carnivore diet for a year, and then let me get another scan. And if in the course of that year, the score doesn't go up at all, then you're doing great, and keep doing what you're doing. And that really becomes the goal, that we stop it from getting worse. And that's, like I said, the thing that I work with patients in my practice on and are getting good results on. Then the next question becomes, can I reverse it? Can I undo some of the damage? And this is a controversial topic. I do have some patients that have lowered their coronary artery calcium score. I always tell people, as long as you stop it from getting worse, you're doing fine. If we get some reversal, even better. And yes, I have seen cases where scores go down some. I don't see them go from, you know, 200 or 500 to zero, but we've seen lowerings of 10, 15, maybe even 20% in some patients.
Oh, wow. Well, that's great. Lower the better, right?
Closer yes, to lower zero, the better. Better. Yeah.
Okay. I have a few questions in my head, but some other people have some questions, so we'll go with those first. Sandra, I was put on statins very young, 30s, even though I was thin and ate healthy food, but heart attack features big in my father's family. I still test huge cholesterol levels every time I stop taking, I guess, the statins.
Yeah. So again, very complex topic. At a high level, you want to be looking at your cholesterol quality, not cholesterol quantity. There is certainly this, phenotype, is the fancy medical term for it that we've now come to recognize. It's been called lean mass hyperresponders. People who go on low carbohydrate diets and their LDL cholesterol goes up dramatically, but at the same time, they have high HDL and low triglycerides. And we are doing active investigation to better understand this. But the data that I see so far would indicate that that is not, those people do not seem to be at risk for worsening cardiovascular disease. And okay. So, and again, it comes back to understanding cholesterol quality versus cholesterol quantity. Now, does that mean that everyone with high LDL should ignore it or isn't at risk? No, not at all. If you have high triglycerides and low HDL cholesterol, and you have high LDL cholesterol, that's a very problematic situation. The only argument that I guess I would have against the traditional approach to this problem, which is take a statin or take another medication and lower your cholesterol, go on a low-fat diet and lower your cholesterol, is that we're not addressing the underlying issue, the root cause, which is insulin resistance and inflammation. And so if you're only addressing your high LDL cholesterol number and you're not addressing the insulin resistance and inflammation that may be present with it, you are still putting yourself at risk for cardiovascular disease. So that's where we need to, you know, go beyond cholesterol and understand that there are more significant and important risk factors for cardiovascular disease and make sure that your doctor is addressing those as well.
Okay, great. Carrie Vore, this is for you. I love this doc.
Thank you, Carrie Vore.
I'm not the doctor here. Okay, and then Liz says, hello. Hello, Liz. I don't know what this word is. Etymon line? Do you know what that means? Or is that a typo?
Yeah.
Okay. It's his final
Eddie M online. Maybe it's someone's username or something.
Oh, okay. Fun. Oh, maybe. Maybe that's what it is. I'm like, is this a medical term? Okay. Oh, it's a dictionary.
Oh, there we go.
Okay. So I'm curious, like, how should kids eat from your perspective? How should kids like...
I honestly don't think the advice is any different for kids. And again, when we look at ancestral, populations, the kids ate the same thing the adults ate. And there's really no reason to think that we should be doing any differently. And I think all of these principles apply. Kids, we're starting to see an alarming incidence of metabolic disease in children. We're starting to see children as young as 8 or 9 years old being diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. Understand what this means. That means that they have advanced metabolic disease that young. What I am starting to see as a heart surgeon is I am starting to see people in their 30s and 40s ending up on my operating table. And that's just, I started my career only 20 years ago. And when I started my career 20 years ago, it was unheard of to have a 30-year-old needing bypass surgery. And now, like I said, it's not uncommon that I'm seeing people in their 30s needing bypass surgery. And the reason it is because they started the metabolic disease process in their teenage years. Again, it's never too early to start this. I have no issues with children, being on low carbohydrate and carnivore diets. A carnivore diet is perfectly nutritionally complete. I want people to understand that. And that's the case whether you're a toddler, a teenager, or an adult. We get all the nutrients we need from eating animal protein. And so there is, that is applicable at any age.
Okay, great. My kids like fruit. We have fruit. I live in a Latino country. They go to grandma's house, they eat rice, but they eat a lot of eggs. They eat a lot of red meat and we try to keep it pretty healthy.
And understand that, when you are metabolically healthy, you can tolerate carbohydrates. So, you know, if, and, you know, the younger you are, the more likely you are to be metabolically healthy. But, you know, I have no problem with people who are metabolically healthy. They're active. They have, you know, muscle mass. They want to eat some carbohydrates and they're whole real food carbohydrate sources like fruit or, you know, a baked potato, then yeah, that's not a problem. You don't need it. So again,
there's no need.
There's no need for it. The carnivore diet is nutritionally complete. You don't need to add anything to it and you get all of the nutrients that you need. But if you want to add it and you can tolerate it from a metabolic standpoint, then, you know, I don't see any problem with that.
Right. I want to inject a funny story. So I visited my family in the States in November and I took my kids with me. And one day I look at my son. Okay. So back up. He was like, Mom, can we please go to McDonald's? I've never eaten at McDonald's before. And I'm like, okay, fine. And then like 25 Happy Meals later, I'm like, Jacob, why are you fat all of a sudden? Like we just, you know, threw away what we were doing here. We went on the Western diet. I gained 15 pounds. My kid got chubby. We came back home and he looks normal again. Like within, it seemed like days he looked normal again, but his face was chubby. His belly was chubby. The same thing didn't happen with my daughter. She wasn't eating the same quantity of food he was. But it was crazy for me to see like how fast he physically went south. I mean, he looks very cute. He didn't look terrible. He wasn't obese, but it was just, wow, you totally changed in a matter of weeks. From eating it, from eating crap. And this is a metabolically healthy kid. So I think that story is so funny because he doesn't look like that here. Even if we go and he eats fast food sometimes, like he's outside in the sun playing. We eat a lot of meat. We eat a lot of eggs. Anyways, just thought I'd
the unfortunate reality is here in the U.S., we really do have the most toxic food supply. And what even when you look at, you know, things that are clearly unhealthy, you know, things like candy bars, and you compare the ingredients in them, you know, the U.S. version versus the, you know, European version oftentimes is what we're looking at. And there's a difference there. And, you know, I've heard many people recount the story. And quite frankly, I have had the same experience where, you know, eating things like bread and pasta in Europe has much different effects than eating those things here in the United States.
Sure. I mean, I can't eat a ton of that stuff even here, but I think the food is better here. Look, I did a video about Coca-Cola and like how terrible it is based on sugar. Cause here in Colombia, it still has sugar in it. Not even high fructose corn syrup. So it's like slightly better for you than I guess what you would find in the US, but it's still terrible. Don't drink Coca-Cola. all right, here we got another question. How receptive are your patients to trying keto carnivore? And can you walk us through your sales pitch to them, please?
Yeah. So, you know, understand that, I guess I'm going to assume that this person is asking about someone who isn't, you know, already doing it. So I lead a dual professional life, right? I'm still a practicing heart surgeon in the hospital and whoever shows up, you know, needing heart surgery, versus I have my private telemedicine practice, where people have usually already, you know, started down this pathway and then they find me. But for the, you know, for the patients in the hospital that are coming to me with heart surgery, you know, needing heart surgery, and I sit down and I have the discussion with them. And the first part of the discussion is understanding that the reason you're here is primarily because of the food that you've been eating. And we have to acknowledge, and unfortunately, the medical system has gotten away from this, acknowledging that the food that we eat is the primary determinant of our health. And then once they understand that, and they understand that, you know, the surgery that I'm going to now do to deal with the blockages in their arteries, is not going to fix the underlying problem. It's a mechanical fix, but you know, that's going to get more blood flow to their heart. But if they don't change what led to them getting the blockages in the first place, you're going to continue to have trouble with heart disease. You're going to get blockages in the bypasses, or if you're getting a stent, the stents are going to get blocked up. So you got to address the underlying problem. This comes down to the food that we're eating. And then for many of them, the discussion is, you know, you've been doing the low fat, low cholesterol approach. You've been taking your medication. It didn't work. You still ended up here. And so many of them are open to a different approach. And then, you know, all of the usual discussions that go into supporting a carnivore diet, that it is our most ancestrally consistent diet. And again, you know, I start with eat real food, and then, you know, again, you can end up where you end up on that whole real food spectrum. But it really isn't, you know, people intuitively understand this. Like when you say to them, eat real food, they're like, yeah, of course, eat real food. No one really argues with that. And then you know, you can kind of work it from there.
Okay, great. And then I know we might have covered some of this earlier, but Liz has this question. I started hearing about people eating butter and tallow along with their protein. I would like to know if eating high fat would cause heart problems. Thank you very much.
So eating high amounts of animal fat is not going to cause heart problems. Eating high amounts of processed fat, things like vegetable and seed oils, certainly can contribute to developing heart problems. Mm-hmm. Again, the misconception that saturated fat is the fat in particular that you'll always hear, oh, that's what was causing heart disease. That myth has been thoroughly disproven. And we now have multiple what we call meta-analysis, which are, reviews of studies that are done showing that there is really no relationship between saturated fat and heart disease. And again, there is no relationship between eating red meat and heart disease. You know, one of the ironic things that comes out of this saturated fat misconception is coconut oil is actually way higher in saturated fat than red meat is. Coconut oil is typically somewhere around 90 to 94% saturated fat. Most red meat is actually only about 40 to 50% saturated fat. And yet, you know, people never talk about coconut oil causing heart disease, and somehow, you know, the red meat causes heart disease. So it never made sense. And it continues to not make sense. So no, animal fat is not going to contribute to you developing heart disease. How much fat you need on a carnivore diet is going to depend on your individual situation. If you have excess body fat, it's better to use that fat than eating, you know, fat to fuel your activities. Before you can use your body fat, though, you have to train your body to use body fat. And if you're coming off a high carbohydrate diet, while you're transitioning, I often advocate for the high fat dietary approach. And then, you know, I oftentimes find that for a lot of people, you then want to dial back the dietary fat, and instead rely on your body fat to provide that energy for you.
Sure. Great. Brooke says this is very fascinating. This is fascinating. Okay. I wonder, do you ever talk about exercise or appropriate exercise? Can we talk about that for a second?
Yeah, sure thing. So, you know, besides the diet, I talk about the other pillars of, a metabolically healthy lifestyle. And this is going to be your activity, your sleep, and how well you manage your stress. Activity, exercise, my main messaging there is you should prioritize resistance exercise. Building and maintaining muscle is actually the best predictor we have of not only how long you live, but the quality of life that you're going to have in your later years. The better that you're able to maintain muscle as you get older, the longer you live and the better quality of life that you have. The other advantage of muscle is it is a more metabolically active tissue, and muscle is a place that we can put excess sugar in the form of glycogen. So there are lots of advantages to having more muscle. And so okay. I always like to focus people on make sure you get your resistance exercise in. And then if you still have time and you want to do more exercise, great, do some cardio. Okay. But that's kind of how I approach the exercise question.
Okay, great. I have a question. Have you heard of this? I'm sure you have, a vibration plate. These like plates you stand on. Would that be considered resistance by any chance?
No, it's not really resistance training. You could probably do resistance training standing on a vibration plate, but in and of itself, it's really not going to be resistance training. Resistance training means moving your muscles against force of some sort. Now, like resistance training, yeah, well, it can be body weight, you know, things like push-up, pull-ups, and squats are great resistance exercises using just your body. And then, yeah, you can use resistance bands. You can use weights. There are lots of different approaches to resistance exercise.
Great. I want to come back around to sleep and stress in a second, but Liz has one more question. One last question, promise. You can ask more questions. We have 9 minutes left, though. I think that you have about 9 minutes, correct?
Yeah. Probably closer to seven.
Minutes. Okay. So what is leptin resistance?
So leptin is another hormone in our body that plays a role in regulating body weight. And leptin is basically a hormone that helps to control your hunger. So, you know, when your leptin levels are high, you tend not to be hungry. In the same way that we can become resistant to insulin, and our cells stop responding to the insulin signal, the same thing can happen with leptin. And so essentially what happens is when you become leptin resistant, you're going to be hungry more and more. And, you know, as I said, hunger is a very tough instinct to overcome over the long run. So leptin resistance may play a role in the development of obesity. And especially in people who are already obese, you know, why they keep eating. Because when you really think about it, you know, if you're obese, you really should never be hungry, right? You have unlimited supplies of energy on your body. And yet, you know, obese people tend to be very hungry. And so leptin resistance may be part of that.
Okay, great. So rapidly, how would someone handle their sleep and or stress? What are your recommendations there?
Yeah, so sleep, you know, lots of the sort of recommendations that go into get good sleep. And what I tell people on the sleep front is it's not only the amount of your sleep, you got to pay attention to the quality of your sleep as well. And, you know, the simple answer on the stress side of things is you can't eliminate stress. None of us lives a stress-free life. You just have to figure out ways to mitigate and manage your stress. And this can be things like meditation, yoga, exercise, having a good community, having good personal relationships. These are all things that can help mitigate stress because being stressed can clearly worsen your metabolic health. Being overly stressed, I should say, and not having a good way to process that.
Sure. Is that because, like, physiologically, it increases your cortisol all the time if you're stressed?
Well, it's because, yeah, it's because of lots of reasons. One of them certainly being the some of the hormonal effects of stress, including raised cortisol levels. But it's real interesting, the science of stress. And the difficulty around the science of stress is we don't really have a good way of measuring stress per se. So it makes it a little bit more hard. Of those four pillars that we talked about, stress becomes the hardest one to sort of quantify.
Sure. I know that if I walk a lot, if I do like I started walking a lot when my kids were visiting grandma, and I just popped the music in, do 10,000 or 20,000 steps. 20,000, I think I did that twice. And I was like, wow, I'm like the calmest person in the universe right now. Like nothing bothered me. So I guess you got to find what works for you to keep that stress exactly. low. Okay. Last question, not accepting anymore after this. So is there any circumstance that anyone should be as scared of eating meat, red meat, any circumstance?
Yeah. The only one that I can think of is a, very rare condition, which really scares the hell out of me. It's called alpha gal syndrome. And this is a condition that after a tick bite, you can become allergic to red meat. It's like our worst. Yeah, crazy. And it's our worst nightmare as a carnivore. And thankfully, it's a very rare condition, but there are cases of it. It seems to be a temporary thing that may go away over time. You can eat red meat. So that's one way around it. But outside of that, no, I really haven't found a situation where, where I tell people it's, at least worth trying. I can't guarantee you what's going to happen, but I haven't really seen anyone get damaged by trying a carnivore diet.
Okay, great. This last comment popped up and I think this is amazing. Law enforcement for 12 years and in debt. That's stressful. But carnivore since April 9th and down 70 pounds. And back to my high school weight and reverse type 2 diabetes. That's amazing. That's a great way to end this live stream.
Awesome, CB. Yeah, I think that's a great way to end it.
Yeah, there you go. All right, everybody. I'm gonna hit end. See y'all later. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.